Since their single Wannabe hit number one in 31 countries, the Spice Girls have sold over 18 million copies worldwide of their debut album Spice. They've won 2 Brit Awards and 2 Ivor Novello Awards and have become the first band to go number one in the UK with their first 5 singles. The Spice Girls are currently the biggest band in the world. And to celebrate the release of their second album, Spice World, you're listening to an exclusive Top of the Pops radio special, The Spice Girls, The Second Coming. I give you Jerry.
But what you have to do is you just have to keep your feet on the ground, remember who you are, so you don't get washed up in your own hype.
Emma.
Me, Melanie, B and Jerry. We just started throwing each other in the mud. It was disgusting.
Mel C.
We want to be the biggest superstars that ever lived.
Mel B.
For bedroom activities only, I think.
And Victoria.
You know, I wasn't a great singer. I wasn't a great dancer. You know, but I knew what I wanted and I had a positive attitude and I went for it.
So fasten your seatbelts and get ready for the ride of your life.
The other girls, they went to stage school and obviously, you know, I always think, oh, why didn't I go? And I've always got that thing with my mother because she never let me go. And so I've had to do it off my own back, really. It's been in my wit and my chat, blagging it, really. It does make it hard, though, sometimes. I've got something inside me that loves dancing, but I'm not trained to pick up routines as fast as everybody else. And that's something that you learn. That's through training. It's good to have the other girls around me because you do pick... You know, hopefully it rubs off a little bit.
I went to Northern School of Contemporary Dance, so it wasn't really a stage school, it was more like training and, you know, how to look after your body and how to learn about the lighting and theatre. So mine was more of a, like, kind of a relaxed kind of thing.
I mean, I've been dancing since I was like 3 years old, and I had a teacher that took, you know, a lot of interest in me, and she really pushed me, and she said, you know, you've got to go to a theatre school, you know, because that will take you to the next level and you can train as a professional dancer. There was times I used to stand in a phone box and cry to my mum and say, I want to come home, and my mum would say, you know, come, you just got to stick it out, you've only got another, you know, 3 years, another 2 years, another 1 year. Because I was never a favourite at college, you know, I never got, you know, lots of jobs and lots of auditions like a lot of the other students. You know, I was always told, you're too this, you're too that, you're too fat, your legs are too short, your hair's too short and all the rest of it. But it was very, very hard and I really had to work for everything I ever did. I mean, I was never one of these people that got it all handed to them on a plate. You know, I wasn't a great singer, I wasn't a great dancer, you know, but I knew what I wanted and I had a positive attitude and I went for it. And luckily I met 4 other girls that... exactly the same as me. I mean, I'd be a liar if I was to stand up and say, yeah, I'm a great singer, I'm a great dancer. I'd be lying because deep down I know I'm not great. There are a lot of people out there a lot better than me. I've just worked really, really hard.
I think I've benefited from my training because I'm very disciplined, which sometimes can be annoying to other people, but I'm thankful for it myself. You know, you wouldn't think I wanted to be a ballerina, but I did. But I never had the physique for it, so. But in my heart, all I ever wanted to be was a pop star. But I just didn't know how to do it, because you don't get taught that at school. And like you don't say, and if you want to be a pop star, you know what I mean? You flunk all your exams. No, they never teach you how to do that.
I love stage school, and I just had such a lovely time. And everyone says, oh, stage school, there's so much jealousy. And it was the complete opposite, but it was just so friendly and happy, and everyone was so together. I loved it, absolutely loved it. I enjoyed working and things like, even though I wasn't the most favourite or I wasn't always on the telly and I wasn't always working, I knew if I was pleasing myself, that was the best I could do. When we were managing ourselves for a year, I think we all had such a strong vision and just thought, right, we're going to try and make this work and we want it to work, so let's just go for it. And we did for a year, which is a long time.
5 girls living together and working together. You know, you're going to have arguments, you're going to have little disagreements and things. So right from day one, you know, we took a really American attitude. If there's something wrong, you've just got to bring it up straight away and we've got to clear it up. So that year, you know, on a personal level, was so valuable to us, really.
They were all really nice, so it wasn't that difficult. It wasn't as though there was, like, any bitches amongst us all, so it was quite easy.
I would say, I mean, from the word go when we started, mentally we were managing ourselves anyway.
When we were in between managers, it was quite a scary time, but we never admitted it to each other because there was always this like underlying thing, like we knew we were going to be all right. But I've always felt like that. you know, just all the way through life, because like I was unemployed for 2 years and I was a trained dancer, and like I was really down and, you know, really depressed, but there's this little thing inside of me also said, don't worry, you're going to be all right. And I think that's what gives you like the strive to go on and try and achieve things. It was a fun time. It's the hard times, I think, when you have the best times, isn't it? Because, you know, we had no money, we had nothing. Jerry had a little battered Fiat that we used to crash every 5 minutes. We'd all be piled in the back of that. And that's when we wrote Wannabe and To Become One. And so some fantastic music came out of that time as well.
I always wanted to fend for myself, you know, I never wanted to ask for money. Because at the end of the day, I could have gone out and got a proper job, but I didn't want to. That was my choice, to not be out earning a regular wage. I think that you learn to cope with however much you're earning. You know, I mean, then, you know, it was not a problem living on 30-something pound a week. And you still have a bit of money left over to go out for a drink on Saturday night, you know, if that's what you want to do. But we really know what it's like to not have any money.
I found it quite comforting, knowing that he's going to get a regular check through.
We're signing on the door. But I don't feel too bad now, because I feel like I've paid my dues back in tax.
Was I desperate to be famous? Yes, I was. I mean, I always dreamt of being famous. My mum was a really big Barry Manilow fan, and I went to see him, and I remember looking at him on the stage, and I actually turned around to my mum and I said, I'm going to be up there one day. And in actual fact, I can remember watching the Smash It's Pole Winners Party, and I can remember thinking, I would give anything to be up there. I'm going to do that. I really want to do that.
I've just always enjoyed performing, and it was something that I'd always wanted to do, but I wouldn't say, oh, hey, I really want to be famous when I'm older. I think I remember I did have dreams of, you know, maybe walking into somewhere and everybody knowing who I was. I think that was quite a dream when you were little.
You know, when I was a little girl, I said, yeah, I'm going to be rich and famous. I am. And it's like any chant, if you chant it enough, it happens, doesn't it?
I've never wanted anything else. Madonna's my idol, and I just wanted to be like her. But not as sexy. I'm not into the sexy thing, as you probably can guess.
Fame, I think, is weird. I was never desperate to be famous. I was always desperate to be heard, or to set an example, or to be able to do my thing, which is performing, which is getting my opinions across on views about my own views about being mixed race, about, you know, being strong, about being a young woman and just going for it. I wanted to be heard for so many different things. I really do, and I still do.
You know this, like, you know, the Ginger Spice, the Jerry, you know, Spice Girl. It's not as if it's not true to me. It is me, completely. That's one thing that we never made the mistake from day one. We've always been ourselves with the media, with everybody. But I suppose sometimes there is the day when you think, oh, you know, they are expecting to see Ginger Jerry Spice. And obviously you don't feel like that person every day. Although it is one part of me, it's not every part of me. You see, and sometimes you read about yourself and you think, oh, is that me? But what you have to do is you just have to keep your feet on the ground, remember who you are, so you don't get washed up in your own hype. Because, like, for example, Victoria's who's sitting next to me, Victoria, no, she's not really posh. Do you know what I mean? The day she starts thinking that she really is, do you know what I mean? Then we've all gone mad.
I wouldn't say I'm playing a character, and I wouldn't say that I turn around and think of myself necessarily as posh. You know, I mean, I wouldn't automatically go around with my head stuck. I mean, I do walk around slightly with my head stuck in the air, but I wouldn't walk around thinking I'm posh, I'm this, I'm that, because, you know, I think you have to remember who you really are. If I'm at home on a Saturday night, I'll still be in front of the television in a tracksuit having a Chinese takeaway. The way I look is the way I dress. You know, if you see me out somewhere, I'll be wearing the same clothes that I would wear when I'm on television. You know, when I'm doing something like that, because I do, that is the way that I am. But of course there's days, you know, when you're getting up at sort of 5 o'clock in the morning to get on a plane and you're thinking, goodness, there's photographers outside my house and I really do not want to be wearing this little dress and silly little jacket when it's December and it's freezing cold.
If in any way we play on it, it's all in good fun. Do you know what I mean? We always like to take the mickey out of ourselves anyway, because we say if you can't take the mickey out of yourself, you can't take the mickey out of anyone else. And it wouldn't be much fun if you couldn't take the mickey out of people now, would it? It's my favourite pastime, actually.
I'm just being me at the end of the day. You can call me scary, you can call me whatever. I'm me.
Generally, I am baby Emma Spice, because that is me from when I was like 8. I was wearing my little baby dolls and pigtails in, and it's like there's a picture of me when I was like 4 and a picture of me now, and I just look exactly the same. Even if I put a little sexy dress on, I have to have my pigtails. It's cuter, it's not as in your face sexy, it's a bit more cheekier. I've always been like that, always.
We get asked a lot about our mums because of single mama. I think, you know, with girls there is a certain bond between you and your mum. My mum's like my best friend, you know, my mum and my sister. Talk to them about absolutely everything. But I love my dad too.
Yeah, dads do get left out a lot. I mean, when I'm on TV, I always go, hi mum. I never think to say hi dad. So I think it's one of them dad things, isn't it? Or is it? I think it is.
Even though I've not lived with my real father for a number of years, we're very, very close. We always have been. So my dad has been there for me. I mean, I'm quite jammy, really. I didn't think so when I was a kid, because like all my mates had mums and dads. But I've got two mums and two dads. Do you know what I mean? So I've got double bonus, more Christmas presents, nice one.
We should do a dadder song, really, shouldn't we?
He wasn't like a proper father in the sense that he disciplined me. I suppose he's more like a grandfather to me. He was 50 when I was born, so by the time, you know, I was old, he'd be telling me wartime stories. And obviously I'm very gutted that he died before I made it, because I was his daddy's little girl. He thought, even if I was ugly or talentless, he thought I was great. I would have loved to spend money on him, because my family was so poor.
My favourite country, I don't think I've found it yet. I mean, I have been to a lot of places, and a lot of places do make you feel that warm feeling when you land, but I haven't got that big feeling yet. But I'm thinking it might be Africa, because I'm going to Africa in about 2 weeks, and then I'm going there around Christmas time, I think. So I think that could be the country that makes me go, wow.
I like not being too far away from home, because when you're stuck in the middle of Asia, you know, you seem quite a long way away from home. I really like Europe. I like France, I like Paris.
If I couldn't live in England and I had to live somewhere else, it would be America. And I think it's because it's probably the most British place, do you know what I mean? Because you can get English things and you can understand, you know, because you speak the same language, well, sort of. Even that can be a bit difficult. I think New York's my favourite place because it really reminds me of London.
Well, my favourite country, Japan, Singapore. The culture is so different and you learn so much when you're travelling, and Singapore is a very beautiful country.
I'm really gradually falling in love with France. I really am. I really love Paris. I love Rome as well. But then again, I like Spain because I'm Spanish and they have really warm reception there. They love us in Spain. So that's really nice. I mean, I know. I think it's what you know as well.
I haven't got a boyfriend at the moment, unfortunately, but I haven't got time for one, have I? I think if I had one, it'd be more difficult because, you know, I'm so busy and, you know, I miss my family and I don't get to see them. So imagine if I had a boyfriend and I'd never see him.
I've got a boyfriend and I do get to see him a lot. The thing with me is if I saw him all the time, we'd probably both get bored of each other. So when we do see each other, it's precious time. And, you know, it makes me laugh. He's got a wicked foreign accent and he's really funny.
I don't know. I'm young, free and single. It's nice to have a cuddle, but then I get a cuddle off the girls and my mum, and I just think I'm so busy at the moment. I haven't got time. Sorry. Just haven't got time for you, mate.
As long as you've got trust there, you know, he comes and sees me, I do go home. As long as, you know, as long as you can trust each other.
No, I don't have a boyfriend. I say with a big smile on my face. I'd like to, you know, have that sort of intimate relationship, but you just have to wait. But I think I'd like to go out with someone like the young Prince of Spain, or maybe Prince Albert of Monaco, because I went to Monaco, right? It was wicked. It was just like really just, I think I live out of movies. I'm a sort of a dreamer.
Out of all the things that we do in Spice Girls, performing live is my favourite thing. I just wish we could do that every single day. But being in a pop group isn't as simple as that. Istanbul was absolutely fantastic. I have never ever been so petrified in my entire life, and I was completely overwhelmed, and like I got a lump in my throat and I couldn't sing like the first chorus because I was going, if we can't dance, if we can't dance, because I had to hold back the tears. And I thought, Melanie, put yourself together. So I had to.
So I suppose the best part of it is, you know, watching the appreciation from the fans. And also it's nice because, you know, my mum always cries.
You can't explain that feeling when you're up on stage doing it live. It's just the best feeling in the world. Well, just have a laugh on tour, definitely. Things will be different every night.
For me, that was my last personal hurdle. Do you know what I mean? I'm not a trained dancer. I thought, God, how am I going to be at doing this? To me now, I just think, right, I can do this. And I'm going to really, really enjoy it. And I think the world tour is going to be even better. It's going to be full of drama and, you know, theatrical. It's going to be full of comedy. You know, it's just going to be a travelling circus.
I wanted to do a tour since I was about 8 years old. It's my dream. It's getting up there. For a start, you're giving back to the fans, and it's just a release. It's like that uncontrollable part in you that just lets rip when you're on stage. There's just no stopping. The routine and everything just is like clockwork, but the actual giving and performing and what you actually feel is exhilarating. It really, really is. No matter how much you perform a song live, there's always something different that you can do on it the next night. And that's just, you want to better and better and better yourself after show, after show, after show. And it's, oh, I can't wait. I cannot wait. Tax Exiles. I think, yeah, you are away from home a lot, but then it's nice because you can fly people out to meet you and you can go off for a weekend and go on like little adventures. Like this weekend, I went and looked at the Eiffel Tower like a real tourist. But it's great, you can get out and about. It's good.
That is something that's really hard for all of us. You know, 9 months we're doing the tour, so that'll be easy, I reckon.
We wouldn't be away anyway, so we thought it was, you know, it was the best thing to do.
Well, we get about 61 days, I think, in the country. You know, we have time off so we can fly people out to come and see us. You know, we do go home, and it's only a year, you know, out of your life, really.
I think my mum misses me quite a bit, but she's just bought a cat, so she's got responsibility with that now.
Sometimes we get a lot of flack for all the, you know, advertisement we've done, all the sponsorship. Also, if you think about it, a racing team, they get sponsored to K, UCF, do you know what I mean? They do, and nobody questions it. And I see the Spice Girls as a team, do you know what I mean? We are out there fighting a cause, so why not?
Don't really think you should eat too many crisps because they're not that good for you. But Walkers are the best. I've always felt that. But I just think it's good for the Spice Girls because there's no way on earth that a record company could afford the mass advertising that Pepsi or Walkers can do. So it's fantastic for us. And we just want to be, you know, seen throughout the whole world. We want to be the biggest superstars that ever lived.
There's no other group that has got as many sponsorship deals as we have, and I think that's great. For a start, it's proven a point that it can be done. And why not? Why not?
I love being involved with chocolate.
People are only talking about it a lot now because it hasn't been done before. And we consider that, you know, it's a lot of exposure that money couldn't really buy. I mean, I'm proud of every, you know, all of our sponsors. I'm especially proud that I'm driving around to Merck as well. And I get free Pepsi.
I'd never consider posing naked unless I really wanted to, for me. Even if you want to get heard or you want to get seen, there are other ways that you can do it that can please you. But if you want to do that, then that's fine. Obviously, you have your reasons for it, but my reason wouldn't be to get heard to do that, no. For bedroom activities only, I think.
Would I have posed naked? No, I wouldn't, because I'm not confident enough about my body.
I don't think so. I haven't got the boobs for it.
If I was offered the right money and I was prepared for a huge argument with my boyfriend and there was a lot of camera tucks and photographic touch-up, I don't know. I don't think I'd go totally nude, no. I like to think that, you know, I've got a bit more to say. I want to be recognised for having a brain.
I have the utmost respect for Jerry, do you know what I mean? I think she's got a fantastic body, so go for it, girl. But personally, I'm a bit shy about my body. I wouldn't show me bits, but I like doing, like, you know, tasteful photographs. I like doing, you know, when you make your ups look like you gorge when you're a dog. Elle magazine. Yeah, I'm into all that, looking like really gorgeous when you're not. If you've got beauty, show it off.
A girl said to me, why don't you do it? And I just thought, oh, okay. I didn't have to go to drama school for this.
This movie is, it's like a British comedy. It's not just a movie about Spice Girls. It is about London, the 90s. It is the biggest piss take on the media. We really take the mickey out of ourselves. My favourite scene in the movie is the alien scene. I've given a bit away.
The favourite scene that I actually didn't like doing, but looking at it makes me laugh, is the assault course. I was really scared because she had to get on this rope and you had to swing over like a big puddle of water and try and get to the other side, and I couldn't do it, and I was absolutely papping myself. But looking back on it, thinking about what I was feeling at that moment in time really does make me laugh. So that's quite a funny scene.
I do a bit in the bath. I like the opening. It opens the Top of the Pops. You know, you do all your TVs in England. But now when you go home to do those TVs, you really appreciate it. You know, it's just so nice to do Top of the Pops, you know, all those kind of things.
For me, it's got to be the performances. There's a performance of Too Much at Top of the Pops. I love doing that. We've got an old performance of Wannabe, which was a laugh. And the finale is a performance of Spice Be Life. They're my favourite bits. Because although I love acting, it's really good fun, but I'm a singer. I don't want to give too much away, but there's always a chase in a movie, isn't there? And the final couple of scenes are really funny, so look out for them.
Well, the one I most enjoyed doing was a scene we did with Michael Barrymore. He has to be like a sergeant major, and he takes us on an assault course. And we all had these like army gear and boots, and we looked properly the part. And then we had to go over all these things and jump into water, and it was just such good fun. And then after we finished the take, because it had been raining, there was this muddy bit, and like through it, me, Melanie, Bee and Jerry were just smothered. We just started throwing each other in the mud, getting our hair, and we've just, it was disgusting. But it was a good laugh.
I know it's not going to last forever. I'll be falling myself. Do you know what I mean? It could all end tomorrow. It really could. So I might as well just, you know, focus on the positive. And we're very realistic about it. We've discussed things very, very openly about what we want to do.
I would like the Spice Girls to continue forever.
At the end of the day, it's down to the public. Some, you know, they might go off us tomorrow, we don't know. But I think we're friends at the end of the day, and whatever any of us do, we're going to support each other. I think because we're just, but mainly, we are best friends. And we're going to be behind each other all the way, and Spice Girls will last forever.
We're there for as long as people want us there for. You know, we're realistic. The band probably together won't last forever. You know, I think you'd be ridiculous to think that. At the moment, we're all really content with our lives. We're really happy. We're enjoying making the music. So that isn't actually something that we've thought about.
Spice philosophy, the Spice vibe will always be there.